For sure, there are discoveries to be made if you simply keep on with a sense of urgent consistency. And this has been the case with me today. A tremendous spiritual breakthrough. Basically, I was able to see and accept a blanket amnesty forgiveness for all the quote-unquote gatekeepers that have stood in my way, in the way of the presence of the inner Christ child, the perfect no to death, have stood in the way and distracted me, etc. And I realized that I had placed them all there specifically for that purpose. So it was my fault, really. I'm the one who put all these gatekeepers. And what are these gatekeepers, actually? Well, this life, all lives, previous life, all the lives, all the bodies, all the relationships, all the things, all the people, all the music, all the experiences, all the antagonists, protagonists, everything, existence itself, the whole universe, is placed there as a gatekeeper. They're all gatekeepers. They're all part of this gatekeeping dynamic, which when you try to get in and have the vision of the Christ child, and they're there saying, you know, no, and wait, you need to do this first, and causing you all sorts of, tripping you up. I was able to see that I've placed all of them there. They're in my employee. They work for me. And so what I did was I said blanket amnesty for all gatekeepers starting right this instant. Total forgiveness, seamless, eternal forgiveness for all gatekeepers. Case dismissed, case closed, it's finished. You're all no longer employed by me. You're all fired. You're gone. No more gatekeepers. And this was a tremendous breakthrough, a tremendous discovery. So if you keep on keeping on, you will find these discoveries where you're able to find yourself in a better position of decision over your own life, own being, own destiny. Just the realization that all of these distractions actually work for you. You have employed them, and they're just doing the job that you gave them to do. But having seen that, you can fire them. You can say, "I no longer need your services." That's it. See, so that's the benefit of seeing this. And so, I know the principle of forgiveness means, actually, we're like jailers. We're the ones jailing the gatekeepers. They want to flee. They don't want anything to do with what their job, but they're forced into doing it. And like they're jailed, we're holding them in jail, in prison. We're imprisoning them, the gatekeepers, forcing them to distract us and turn us away. So we can free them from jail. Free them from jail. So everybody, all the gatekeepers, everything that's functioning as a gatekeeping function is free from jail. No more jail ever. You are absolutely free. In fact, go. Can't hang around here anymore. And so you're no longer the jailer. You see that? So forgiveness really frees you from being the jailer. Because as long as you're the jailer, you're constantly nervous and making sure those gatekeepers are in place and doing their functioning. You have to crack the whip on them, keeping us quote-unquote safe from the true darshan, the true viewing, the true being in the presence, the inner presence of the Christ child, which is that perfect assurance that no, you cannot die. Eternal, nothing can die. Eternal life can never die. It's this perfect assurance. All the gatekeepers do is they keep us away from that. Plain and simple. So, seeing that this is something that I have power over, I have power over my own gatekeepers, I can fire them, I can set them free, liberate them, and tell them, go, you're not wanted, you're not needed here anymore. And I was able to extend that bit by bit, one example, another example, and gradually it generalized and extended to the entire universe. I was able to forgive the entire universe for everything that I think it's ever done to me. I was able to do that mentally. forgive the entire universe for every last thing I have thought it's ever done to me. All experiences forgiven. All memories forgiven. All interactions forgiven. All lives forgiven. All suffering forgiven. Everything. I was able to blanket seamless forgiveness. Perfect forgiveness. I was able to extend that perfect forgiveness. Now, the dividends have not yet shown up. And in fact, this afternoon again, I'm tired once again. Suffering from debilitating fatigue. The morning was pretty good, but then about 1:45 this afternoon, just completely ran out of battery, low battery. But that's the way things are going right now. And but that doesn't detract at all from being able to make this blanket perfect forgiveness. And my mind was easily able to do that. Easy. No trouble at all. So that's an example of how all this effort on the path of inquiry and looking to clarify, how it is shown to start, that it does progress and get you to a point where you can do something you thought is impossible to do before. You thought, no way, how could I ever possibly feel that way? But in seeing it in the correct context, I said, okay, I see that these are just gatekeepers. They're just, I put them there to distract me, because I was afraid of this perfect no, didn't want to be in its presence. So these gatekeepers kept me away from it, and of course I blamed them, saying, these terrible gatekeepers, aren't they awful? They're preventing me. But no, I'm just preventing myself and using them as a crutch to do so. And everyone is doing that. So everyone has this opportunity to extend perfect forgiveness. And again, this includes everything that's ever happened or ever will happen. All blanket amnesty forgiveness forever. No, slate wiped and completely clean. Every impression we've ever gotten, forgiven. Every thought, forgiven. Every experience, forgiven. Everything. Totally forgiven. Therefore, it's out of your mind. It's out of your hair. You're not jailing anything. Everything's out of jail. Everything's out of jail. And so you don't need to keep it around. You don't need all those thoughts and memories, etc. Because what you see is that all of it was actually used as a gatekeeping function. Everything that you've experienced functions as a gatekeeping function, as something other than actual being in the presence of this perfect no assurance and this perfect remembrance of what we really are. Everything we've done has been a gatekeeping function. Good, bad, the ugly, all of it. So especially forgive the good, you know, all this good stuff, all this stuff. That's still totally part of the dynamic of a gatekeeper. Because you get there and the gatekeeper, the good, will say, hey, you know, you're really good. You know, here's another something I realized again today. That we are trying to impress God with how good we are, okay? This is the big mistake. We're trying to impress God. Say, God, look how great I am. We're trying to impress God. Whereas God, the real, we have it backwards. We're supposed to accept that God is telling us how great we are, how great God sees us. So we're trying to say, hey God, we're trying to impress God. No, that's wrong. That is all wrong. We don't need to impress God. We are so busy trying to impress God, we have no time for accepting God's impression, how God really sees us. We're too busy saying, look at this, look at my dance, God. I'm dancing so great. I'm already dancing great. We're trying to impress God, whereas God is trying to tell us how impressive we truly are from God's standpoint, and what how God sees us, instead of how we see God in terms of, hey God, you must see me as really great, look what I'm doing. We've twisted it backwards. We don't need to impress God. We need to accept how God sees us. Accept the remembrance of God, how God sees us. It's God that is trying to impress us with what we are. Okay, we're trying to impress God by what we do. God is trying to impress us with what we truly are. See, we have it backwards. We're trying to build up an impression. Hey God, look how impressive I am. Whereas God is trying to tell us trying to impress us with what we truly are. It's God's impression of us that is important. And we're supposed to accept that. Okay. Not our attempts to impress God. See? So we have this twist there. So the gatekeepers tell us, hey, you know, are you sure you've impressed God enough? And you say, oh, I don't know, maybe not. I better keep trying to work on impressing God. Whereas what we're supposed to do is be impressed by God. Okay, be impressed by remembrance of God, of reality. So we don't have to do anything. If we're just, all we're doing is we're being impressed by God's gift to us. We don't have to do anything. Just sit and look, accept it, feel it, experience it, abide in it. Say, wow, that's super impressive. God is really impressive. See? We're supposed to feel, wow, God is truly impressive. Reality is so impressive. Instead of saying, God, look at how impressive we are. Aren't we making a great impression upon you? All right, do you get this? We're sorting it out here. So when we go into this looking, being in the presence of this inner Christ child, we're being supremely impressed by this Christ child, saying, wow, that is so impressive. Instead of going in there and saying, hey, I'm here to impress you, Christ child, let me do my dance and look at all the stuff I've done, the great stuff I've done. And he's not interested in anything we've done. Christ child is not interested in anything we've done. It's simply conveying to us what we are. Have always been. Not what we've done, but we've always been. So what we've done doesn't matter in the slightest bit. All that is just gatekeeping function. All of that is just gatekeeping function. And we think, I'm not impressive enough yet. I don't think I can impress the Christ child yet. We don't need to. We need to be impressed by God, impressed by remembrance of reality. So we're there to be impressed, not to impress. We need to be impressed, not to impress. Okay? And a lot of times when we're trying to describe then the subtlety of being impressed, we're so impressed by remembrance of reality. We think, wait a minute, I need to impress God by putting it into words. But again, we're not trying to impress God at all. Or I need to put it into a song. I need to put it in a book. I need to symbolize it. Say, look how impressive I am, God. Look at what I'm able to do. I'm able to symbolize this, what your remembrance. How impressed I am, able to symbolize it. No, God doesn't need that. God doesn't need us to symbolize how impressed we are by reality. See, that's still trying to impress God with how great we are. God doesn't need to be impressed by how great we are. We need to be impressed by the remembrance of how great reality is. That doesn't require anything on our part. It already is that way. Always has been that way. So these are examples of the mind getting to see this, being able to see these underpinning facets of important dynamics here that come from making the effort, day after day after day, making the effort. So there is a type of progress. The more you try to look, and the more effort you make to looking, real looking, trying to see, and allowing yourself to be impressed by what you see. It's like saying, wow, that's an amazing insight, amazing that this forgiveness is possible, like this blanket forgiveness. Wow, it's very impressive. The more effort is made, the closer you get to being more and more impressed. You're going in that direction. I was at a house today. That was very impressive, actually. oh my gosh, this was like a incredible setting, incredible jewel, mansion estate, and overlooking incredible serenity and the atmosphere and everything. It was just like, wow, a real prize type of home. I just kind of looked around and said, oh, okay. Yeah, but you know, that's a gatekeeper too, right? Because they're saying, who needs to be impressed by God when we can show what an impressive house and location we have, right? So you settle into how impressive you are instead of how impressive God is. And how impressive your true, how impressive reality actually is. So, the good stuff of this world is just as much a gatekeeper as the bad stuff of this world, really. We say, why do we need to experience the presence of the Christ child, but we have this mansion and estate on a golf course, and you know, it's just everything is like, it's so beautiful, and all these trees and a beautiful mansion. Oh, why do we need that? We don't need that. Look how impressive we are. God must be very impressed by what we've done here. Now, that's not it. We need to be impressed with reality, the way the reality is, which is the perfect, you know, first of all, Christ child, perfect no to all impermanence, all death, all illusion of process, all of that perception, perfect no, never can be true, never can be a fact, never can be real. The perfect no, that is very impressive. That's what we need to get to. So we need to continue to be impressed by what is revealed to us as we make efforts to keep looking in the right direction. And the impressiveness is not coming from us, so to speak, not really. It's just there, like to be discovered. It's like we're miners and we keep mining, we keep finding nuggets of gold. You know, did we make the gold? No, I mean, for example. And it's the gold itself that's impressive. And we just were willing to discover it, you know, it's there. So the trouble comes when we try to then turn it around and be impressive about it and say, okay, I need to write a million page book and talk about it or something, or I'm going to compose 1,000 songs and stuff. But no, that's not it. We need to set the example of not doing that and simply abide in the impression that God is making upon us. Abide in that. As, for instance, Ramana Maharshi, just abide in it. That's the example. That's the important thing to do. And if we want to try to write some songs about it, the thing is we'll stop abiding in it, because abiding in it is so perfect, so impressive, we don't want to leave it, and we can't imagine, you know, you cannot make any music that it can touch upon how impressive, you know, this perfect no is, really. So if we want to do that, we'll have to stop abiding in it and kind of forget what it was really like, so that we can presume that this song captures the essence of it, when in fact it doesn't. 1 minute, please. So we're touching on the all-important issue of being impressed by this perfect gift of remembrance. And that's all we're supposed to do, is be impressed by it. just stay in that state of being impressed by it and just say, wow, this is incredible. Just stay in. There may be those who say, wow, you're so impressive. Or the situation is so impressive. So you have to just accept that because it's the situation that's impressive. The fact that you're being impressed means that there's something super impressive. So they're impressed about that. Okay, they're not really impressed with you to a lesser extent. It's a good thing. It's impressive to, well, it's all testimony to the impressiveness of what is there, because that is what attracts people along the spiritual path, is they have some experience that is so incredibly impressive that they say, I just have to get back to that. All right, that's the common theme, is once you have that experience that where you're supremely impressed, then you really have no choice but to try and get back to that. And then when we struggle, we say, oh, you know, it's really a struggle, but we're getting to it. We're getting to it. That's how I feel. By being able to just look at this calmly, dispassionately, non-esoterically, non-metaphysically, just, you know, straight looking at it. Inquiry. Satsang means looking at it. Knowing what to look at and what to look for, instead of going off on all these tangents. The whole point is to be able to keep turning your attention to what is important to look at. That's the whole game, the whole effort, your attention. And keep guiding your attention back to what is really crucially important. And that's the struggle, because this world is trying to distract your attention in infinite ways. And the battle just, you know, keeps going on and on and on. So we really do need to reach a safe haven for our attention, where our attention finally says, no, I'm sticking to this. I found something that I'm going to stick to, because this is my you know, highest responsibility that is necessary. It's the right thing to do. And trying to leave this, stop abiding in this and being impressed is the entirely the wrong thing to do. There's simply no justification for it whatsoever. And again, fire all your gatekeepers. Dismiss them all. You're all dismissed. Blanket amnesty, forgiveness forever. Now you're all dismissed. Never, don't come back. I don't want any of you coming back at all. Never. Now your thoughts and impressions and everything may kind of be in the distance, or they may retreat. You know, I'm sure once we are truly impressed and abide in being impressed by this perfect no, everything that we have accumulated over all the time is going to be entirely unimpressive by comparison. So unimpressive that we're not even interested in it. That's a fact. It's like we're gathering little bits of gold, little tiny little flakes, little tiny bits, and we have all these collections of all these little tiny nuggets and flakes. And then we come across this gigantic boulder of, you know, pure gold. And we look, after experiencing that, we look at these tiny little nuggets and it's not impressive anymore. I mean, it was probably impressive when we first found them, but at this point now I say, no, it's not impressive anymore. So you lose interest in it. As far as being impressed, it has no more power to impress you. And we forgive ourselves for ever being impressed by it, for ever being distracted by that. We forgive ourselves, blanket forgiveness for everything. So this has to be, you know, we're going through the narrow gate, as it were, of our attention is getting in the right place with all this. And this is, you know, this is what, October 16th, it's hump day in more ways than one. It is getting over the hump of October from 15 to 16 with a 31-day month. The 16th then would be the hump day, as it were, 15, 16. And it's Wednesday. which is hump day of the week. So it's a big day today, actually, to and the debt ceiling, government shutdown, all that stuff is set to be resolved also. So it's a pretty interesting time right now. And, you know, our aim is success. Our aim is success here. Not just fooling around. It's success. Success in being impressed. Allow ourselves to be impressed. And then the ego will say, well, if you're so impressed, something's so impressive, why don't you prove it by impressing others with, you know, some representation of it? No, that's a trick. That's a trick. Don't fall for that. Because this experience is within us, and people will get a glimpse of it, and then they'll, if you speak about it, they will know, they will hear, and they'll say, yeah, I remember, I did have something that was supremely impressive, and so how do I get back to it? You know, don't try to throw up some big, impressive symphony about it, you know? That's not the way. That's the ego is trying to trick us that way. Because that won't be impressive. Not at all. The stuff of this world is not impressive. Pale, faint, pale shadow at very best, which is not right to be impressed by it. There's nothing of this world that's actually impressive. Nothing. And intuitively we feel that, you know, we think, wow, we keep trying to find something in this world that's impressive, but nothing is really impressive. It's just very feebleness. But the perfect no is definitely impressive. Once you've experienced this inner experience of this purity, you know, it's just like, wow, that is truly impressive. And so, why try and represent that symbolically? That's stupid. The ego, that's trying to show how impressive you are through your cleverness and representation. That's not the goal. Being clever in representation is not the goal. The goal is to directly experience, to directly be impressed. And in order to do that, you have to spend your time clarifying and listening to the voice of reason, not through trying to arrange some sophisticated symphonies to show how clever and sophisticated you are with manipulating symbols. You know, that's not it. And people say, well, I can't get there. Just give me some candy, you know, give me some photograph of it or something. And you have to say, yes, you can get there. And you have to get there. And the way to get there is not by looking at trying to find some representation of it, but by listening to the Holy Spirit. For instance, all this like artwork, New Age artwork and stuff, it looks so incredible, you know. But really, it's feeble. And it's better to spend your time in contemplation and inquiry and satsang. That's the right way to use your time, for sure. Because like I have shown in this video, the mind is easily able to then actually extend blanket, seamless, total forgiveness to the entire universe, the history of the universe, all of time and space. The mind is able to easily do that. That is, you know, something that is truly important to do. And you can sit back and smoke dope and look at groovy New Age art from now to, you know, for however long you want to. It's not going to clarify for you what needs to be clarified, because there are issues that have to be clarified. You have to get to the point of this perfect forgiveness, and you have to get to this point with understanding that you're there to be impressed by the Christ child. The perfect know of the Christ child, and you're there to abide in this impression, because it's a gift of remembrance. You have to be very clear about all of that, and so you have to spend your time in clarification instead of trying to do some, you know, groovy artwork or something. And you know, most of us have been there and done that. It's still tempting at times, you know. For sure. I mean, I can wake up and, you know, think, wow, I can go I could compose many songs today. If I had the studio, and if I had what I needed to do, I could actually do it for sure. And jingle, commercial jingles, really impressive commercials, anything creative I could do. But no, instead, spending the time looking carefully at these key core issues is the right use of time. But the ego is always tempting us, and hey, you could be a great this and this, or you could do this really great. No. One minute. All right, distractions arising there. What can you do, right? You know, the temptation when you come across this the inner Christ child is so impressive, the impression is so incredible, is the ego tells you, hey, if you could channel this inspiration you're getting into some form of art, you would be the greatest artist ever. And you think, wow, you're right, I could. And then you'll end up spending a lifetime trying to do that and never get back to this, you know, darshan of the inner Christ. It's terrible. I mean, it's happened to a lot. It's happened to me. It's happened to a lot of people. When you get this experience, you think, wow, I can be super creative. I'm going to help the world through my great creative inspiration. I'll do such inspirational artwork and books and whatever. You know, you'll be super, super great creative person or something. The temptation is just like extreme. And it's so vexatious to struggle with this for so many years. But I know many people do. It's just, if you really want to impress someone, if you really want to convey how impressive what you see is, you won't try to put it into any words or concepts or art or symbolize or anything like that. You'll say, it's so impressive that anything you try, any way you try to represent it, is going to severely detract from what it really is. So to such an extent, it's going to give a very wrong impression, which is going to be harmful, actually. And it's so impressive, you say, you don't want to leave it. The ego will say, well, you're very selfish, you don't want to share it with others. Just the opposite. I do want to share it with everyone, which is why I'm not leaving it, because that's how to share it. You're showing people how impressive it really is, and therefore the effort they need to make to prepare for it. So you're giving them pragmatic help, not some kind of romantic help, like let me write some beautiful sonatas or something, you know, just some frothy, frilly songs or something that just seems so impressive. Now, there's no preparation needed for that. That's letting people off the hook. If it's really impressive, why let them off the hook? If something is truly magnificent and impressive, don't let them off the hook. Did Ramana let us off the hook? No, thank God that he didn't. Right? He didn't let us off the hook. He just sat there and said, this is totally impressive what I'm experiencing. I'm not leaving it. It's too impressive to leave. So, see, that's being of real service. The ego has got this completely deceitful way of presenting what service really is. Keep in mind that the impressiveness of it all is not an end in itself. It's a gift of remembrance, and it's our responsibility to remember. And so it's a duty, it's a responsibility. To abide in it. Just a second. All right, more distractions. Just keep soldiering on, what can you do? So the ego will scream that you're selfish, you're selfish, you're selfish, you're not sharing with other people, etc., etc., etc. And so we have to dispel this insanity, this falsity. This is a gatekeeper function for others. Others will have to see through this deception. How is setting an example of responsibility, how is that selfish? That's ridiculous. How is that not helping others? That's the ultimate way to help. It's the only way to help. See, the ego doesn't want that. It doesn't want them to inquire. The ego wants to have them spoon-fed some piece of art or some piece of culture or something. That they say, this is good enough. See, how impressive. Look how impressive your fellow humans are to make something impressive like this. Isn't that amazing? How impressive you are. Wow. And that short circuits actually being impressed by God. By reality, it's we need to be impressed by reality, not by our cleverness in arranging colored glass or something, you know? No, that's not it. That's what we need to get free of. The peace beyond understanding is what is truly impressive. And to know without us, without another, is what is truly impressive. It's not a conceptual no. You see, that's the thing that's impressive. It's something that is truly impresses us. Meaning there's something within us that can relate to it, which is, you know, the ego can't relate to it. You see, the ego can't relate to it. So it says, give me something that says yes, that I can relate to, and then I'll help everybody else. No, ego, you cannot help anyone. You only delay. Yes, yes, we can will never take place. That's delay. So this kind of information kind of burns, you know, it's a tough one. It burns. If you do inquiry right, and you have been, you know the burn, this feeling like, it's a tough one. It's just like, wow, just burning the ego. The ego just hates this. Like Jesus said, if you speak the truth in his name, the world will hate you, the ego will hate you. The ego hates this type of stuff. So you'll feel your ego just suffer, saying, I can't stand this, you know, I'm leaving. Gatekeepers, let the gatekeepers leave. You know, free them, be proactive. Say, look, you're all dismissed, I insist. I hired you, now I'm firing you, I'm dismissing all of you. Every last bit of it. All forgiven, I'm not punishing any of you. Not blaming any of you, punishing you. You're completely blank slate. You're pure, completely forgiven. Nothing on your record at all. In other words, you're free and clear, forever free and clear. And then you too will be recognize how you're really free and clear in reality. But the ego is I'm feeling this like kind of a suffering going on. Like wow. It's losing its footing. It's losing its place in the psyche. It's being dismissed. So you should always try and reach that point of feeling like, wow, this is just a tough one. And then you know you've gotten into territory you needed to get into. It's like you're doing a root canal. I mean, you're getting into, you hit a nerve. You have to hit a nerve And then you know you're getting somewhere. And with practice, you don't react to it, you just recognize it. Roji talks about Punjaji hitting a nerve in him, a severe nerve. You know, and he just hit so hard they just couldn't take it or something. But that's just an example. But in all inquiry, you're supposed to, you go there for the purpose of having a, you know, you're going to the dentist. You got a cavity, you know, and so. But the dentist, a good dentist, dulls it down, you know, dulls the pain down, gives you anesthesia, so it doesn't hurt so much at all. Good dentist, absolutely. They'll help you look at something, and you say, it doesn't hurt so bad. But there's kind of a dull ache within you. Whereas if you don't have this anesthesia, you might be, you know, psychically, it's too much pain psychically or something. So I guess the guru is like a good dentist. And the Christ child is like the perfect dentist. That you will easily accept the perfect no. Even though you may feel like, I wonder if this is painful for my psyche. But you're so anesthetized to that, so to speak. You say, it doesn't really matter. I don't really care whether it is or painful or not. Eventually, the pain will wear off. I don't feel anything. Right? You know, now it's. And of course, a good dentist will be talking to you and all this stuff, and you're not even nervous at all, not even thinking about anything, and not worried. And before you know it, you're walking out the door with a smile on your face. You say, I didn't feel a thing. Cavity's gone. Whatever the trouble is, it's gone. So one doesn't need to focus too much on the pain, the suffering like that. Just say, okay, there's something going on there I can feel, but that I'll just keep on, just stay in the positive, humorous, happy that you're making progress, focus. And it just, that's what works. I mean, I could introspect now and look at all the, you know, the pain and all, but no, it's let it dissolve. Let it dissolve. It's hitting it with some kind of, you know, something that's dissolving it. Just let it dissolve. See, was Ramana some artistic genius? No. No, almost did nothing. Same with Ananda Maharaj. She didn't do anything as far as art is concerned, or writing, or nothing. Just sitting, just sat there. That's it. And people say, what a waste. They could have, you know, used their energy for making beautiful things, saying jewelry for people, they can wear some nice earrings or something. How come they didn't, you know, make some nice settings for diamonds or something? And that's really important. And that would be very impressive. How come they didn't do this, and that? The ego has got it totally insanely backwards, upside down. It just doesn't understand at all. The ego does not understand what the goal is at all. In fact, it rejects it. It cannot appreciate it at all. So free all the gatekeepers. Dismiss all the gatekeepers. Forgive all the gatekeepers. Forgive the ego for being such an obnoxious gatekeeper. And for insisting that you do, that you represent your, how you're being impressed. What are the impressions you're getting? Tell us what the impression. They say, hey, you have to find out for yourself. I'm not going to remove your motivation to find out for yourself. You can do it. Everyone can. It's the Holy Spirit that does it for you, really. they say, how mean of you. You should share this with us. Why? And remove your motivation? Even if I could, no, you have to be motivated to get there. And they'll make all sorts of claims. Well, you're not motivating us. I say, oh, sure, that's not true. Not true. But it cannot be expressed. You cannot express the ineffable. Really, it's completely ineffable. You can't even say that word. Any expression is again putting in the oneness into duality. You know, is stupid. And the ego say, well, I'll never be able to be helpful. Well, never, the ego never is helpful. So there's a gatekeeper, and that we're supposed to let go of that sort of help. So again, we just keep on keeping on with this. And on to the next breakthrough, on to the next being impressed by the next clarification. And we should have impressive dreams, you know. Even we go to sleep, the dreams should impress us like this. Wow, I had a dream. It was just incredibly impressive. Sometimes I feel like the breakthroughs come in dreams because we're asleep, and the idea is that we wake up, we lose the impressiveness of it, so we cannot really rush out and try to be creative about it. Like, it's gone. Oh, it's gone. I can't quite remember what it was. I can't really write it down, you know. It's some way dynamic of that. Or it's our desire to use our waking time in trying to be impressive that we push this stuff into sleeping time stuff. That could be it also. So let's look at this. Because almost all of my very experiences that are truly incredibly impressive have been during while sleeping, but when during the daytime, you know, nothing has occurred. So it might be because I want to use all my waking moments to try and be impressive creatively, so I don't want that to be impinged upon by something that's truly impressive that will stop me in my tracks and just say, wow, I'd rather just be impressed by this than try to do something impressive. That could be it. So then it gets pushed into, you know, the sleeping time where I'm, you know, not able to do anything. And I say, okay, well, I'm asleep now anyway, so I might as well, you know, experience it now. So I guess the key then would be to drop this, to allow it to happen during, you know, waking time and be impressed during that time. So when we start talking about sleep and waking and actually looking at it in this broad way, that's a very good place to be, actually. You're looking at your psyche from a different viewpoint when you start to do that. You say, why am I even sleeping at all? Why am I dreaming? Why do these things happen during sleep and not during waking time? Being able to then find answers for this. That's changing your psyche, really. It has profound effect on your psyche. Just like forgiving all the gatekeepers. That is, you know, like forgiving your psyche. It's got to be a transformative type of perspective. It's a perspective, really. Being able to look at it in that way, it's a new perspective. So the effort to keep looking outside the box, keep looking inside, it pays off by being able to look at this, your psyche, in a whole different way, actually, the whole situation, different explanation. And the question is, do you even need your psyche? As a psyche, do we even need that, or can we just be impressed, truly impressed, and live a life of being impressed by remembrance of God? What do we need a psyche for in terms of that? People say, well, you need to express it to others. No, you don't. Because the way to it is through clarification, not through expression of it. And any expression you can give will pale in comparison to the inner experience. And people who want expressions of it are afraid of the inner experience. They don't want to impinge upon them being impressive. They want to learn how to be impressive. So they want something, some great piece of art or something that they can study and figure out, how can I be so impressive, you know, to make this music or art or something? How can I be so impressive? That's what they want. They're afraid of the experience of being really, truly impressed. And I understand. Having had those experiences, it's just like, wow, you know, wow. It's like incredibly impressive. I just like, can't even be speechless. You don't want to say anything about it. You're just, you know, experiencing it like, wow, this is just absolutely fantastic. Wonderful. So, yeah, people want an excuse to not have that happen, but that's robbing them of it, you know. That's helping them prevent them from having that. It's aiding and abetting delay, and they don't want to do that. They, you know, we all are capable, the mind is capable of being truly impressed by reality, and we have to find that out. We have to discover that. Nobody should be, you know, helped to avoid that. The ego tells us, it's terrible, you know, you're going to be ruin your life, etc. Well, it doesn't ruin your life, it changes your life. And the ego says, you'll never be impressive. Once you get that, you'll never be impressive. Well, that's true, because it takes away time from your, you know, genius at being clever and creative. That is very true. In my previous life, I was super clever and inventive and creative, and very impressive. People were extremely impressed by what I could do. But in this life, having these experiences, you know, I couldn't do that to other stuff. I said, this is more important. I'm so impressed by these experiences I've had that I don't have time to try, you know, and compete with it or express it. Forget it. No way. I heard the celestial music of everything in the world and in the universe was sounding a note. Okay, everything, pure note, and everything was synchronized in some harmonious, you know, incredible sound, and it was so mind-blowing, totally mind-blowing. The idea of writing symphonies or something is so ridiculous compared to that. You can't even, you know, it's just ludicrous. I said, wow, I'd rather hear this than any symphony we could ever accomplish in this world. It's like nothing compared to it, nothing. So I said, how can I hear this? You know, music of the spheres or something. Every blade of grass had a tone. Every speck of dust, everything. But nothing interfered with anything else. It was all in harmony. All the tones were in harmony. It was like rich beyond imagination. Totally. I said, wow, I'd rather hear that than try to impress others, you know, with mixing up a few little muddy tones together. That's ridiculous. So once you have these experiences, it does knock out your creativity, which is a good thing, you know, assembling fragments. It takes that. You're not going to be known for that. That is true. But at some point, you'll be known for having dropped that, being able to actually get past that, which is what you really want to be known for. Anyway, so it's an ego thing. I mean, people are so wanting to be so impressive, they don't want to experience something that's truly impressive. Then they'll realize, oh, this human endeavor is ridiculous. Yeah, forget it. They're afraid of that, for sure. Absolutely. They want to be famous. They want to be great. And so, okay, fine. Be famous, be great, whatever. And then you will have the experience and you'll say, I've been there, done that, and it's not worth it for me anymore. Not worth it. Small time stuff. Penny ante stuff. Why should we? Our destiny is not to be involved with this penny ante stuff. Such trivial stuff. Worthless stuff. You know. That's not our destiny. So we got to get about our destiny. That's our responsibility. We cannot just continue to wander in this worthless, trivial stuff. That's not befitting us at all. It's a way to try to forget what we are. Is really what it is. We're trying to die to what we are. Die to the remembrance of what we are. We're trying to die the remembrance of what we are. We're trying to make what we are a memory and then die to that memory. But the inner Christ child tells us we can't. We can't. And it's within us, and it's always within us. So no matter how much long we try to die to the memory of what we are, the perfect memory is within us. The perfect know that we cannot do this is within us. Still there. Can't get rid of it. So it's futile. Why waste time? Why waste time trying to get rid of it? What you can't get rid of. And people talk about the great experiences they have in nature, like, oh, I saw this sunset over this place, and the moonrise, the full moon, and the jungle, and the birds, and the quiet guy. Oh, it's like so incredibly great. Wow. You know, and then, but that's, again, that's trivial. Very trivial. So keep on clarifying. Keep on clarifying. Keep on clarifying. And, you know, that's what you have to do. If you just realize, hey, I'm not going to be great through my cleverness in this world, then don't waste time in feeling sorry for yourself. Go for the gold. Go for the you know, what's really important. Go for it, and you'll get it. Go for being truly impressed, like, wow. And eventually pulling it out of the dream state, you know, and into where you have a third state that's neither dreaming nor waking, because you're continually impressed. So you don't need the waking state of trying to be clever, the dream state of trying to avoid being clever, you know, and you're just simply accepting the state of abiding in this incredible experience. So I'm sure some of this is sinks in, you know, a little bit sinks in here and there. There's a lot of concrete, but there's some cracks in the concrete. The water seeps in and gets to the roots of something down there, little flowers trying to grow, and it's still being nourished, and eventually it will, you know, break the concrete. So don't worry, there's concrete there, it's fine. Just keep widening the cracks, keep letting the rain in. Keep expanding the concrete, you know, expand that cracks that keeps cracking the concrete. Keep expanding your mind outside the box. Keep cracking the concrete of the box. Yeah, the world won't see the greatness of that. The ego doesn't see it. It says, you're doing nothing. You're not creating it. You're not making anything. What are you making? Nothing. Wasting your life, the ego says. From its measurement, it wastes your life. But actually, it's just the opposite. It's the ego that's wasting your life. And completely mundane, trivial, nothing, meaningless, wandering about. Another great day around the bay. Ridiculous. And yet, no matter how great the climate is, you can still feel terrible here. In fact, no, easy to feel terrible here. The rest of October should get better. It should be breakthroughs. Should be breakthroughs. There have been breakthroughs all of this October, but there should be, I foresee, some extremely powerful big breakthroughs coming. I don't know what the next crisis will be, I'm sure in the world it will arrive in time. It always does. It's just we've been going from one crisis to the other, right? Okay. All right. That's it. The bugs are flying all over the place, and we're going to go get some dinner. Very great. That's it for this one.